Hello, and welcome to part 3 of my VR weapons tutorial for Godot. In this part, we're finally going to fire our gun and hit a target. But before we begin, we need to look at a little bit of housekeeping I did off camera. I had to change the collision mask of the teleporter and enable the environment physics layer, else the teleporter wouldn't interact properly with our collision shapes. In our pickup function script, we have to divide the velocity we calculated by our delta to get a more useful speed per second value. This also means our default impulse factor was way too high. We will play more with this in a future video. In our range scene, I've completed all the collision shapes for our walls. Our player is now contained within our play space. While I think the plane shape we used in the last video works really well, people get stuck when they do not realize everything on one side of the plane becomes unreachable. Using box shapes more clearly shows the restrictions in the play space. Do make sure that you do not make your box shapes too thin. Fast-moving objects can go straight through a thin box shape. There is a setting in physics to prevent this, but it is costly. It is a little hard to see here, but I've also adjusted the position of our pickup function anchor point. Now, when we grab our gun, it is nicely placed as if we're holding it in our hands. Finally, I've increased the energy setting on our GI probe just to make everything a little brighter. Okay, let's get started with creating something to shoot at. I'm adding a node to our range scene that becomes a parent for all our targets. We'll add a statics body to our targets node. This static body will be the root node of our first target. To this, we'll add a mesh instance node. We then set the mesh for this to a quart shape. After moving it up a little, we see that our mesh is facing the wrong way. We'll rotate our mesh to face the right way. I'm also changing the size of our mesh here so that it is 2 meters high instead of the default 1. Before we continue, let's quickly save our target into its own scene. We create a subfolder inside of our models folder where we can save our target. Let's move our target into position in our target lane. Note that when I move it forward, I'm moving our parent forward. I'll have to fix that up in the next video. Let's go to our new scene. We'll add a material to our mesh instance. We'll select a nice target texture for our target. In order to detect if we hit our target, we'll need a collision shape. We are again using a box shape that we nicely size to fit our mesh. Finally, we need to set the collision layer of our target to our objects layer. We don't really care about the collision mask. Now that we have a target that we can hit, we need to make our gun actually fire at it. There are many different techniques and variations of techniques. We're going to start with one of the simplest ones, using a raycast. Raycasts make the assumption that you hit your target pretty much as you pull the trigger, which seeing the speed of a bullet isn't too far from the truth. You could always delay checking the raycast a few milliseconds after pulling the trigger. In many games where you do see the bullet travel, this is mostly done for artistic reasons. We won't look into things like bullet drop and sway just yet, nor in projectiles, but I will be covering both at some point in the near future. If you've tackled FPS games before or have followed tutorials for standard FPS games, you will know that it's standard practice to child the ray cast to the camera and cast the ray dead center out of the camera. This is because that is the way you are aiming in a traditional FPS game. More often than not, the positioning of the gun mesh is chosen more on artistic reasons than realistic ones, as a hip-fired gun wouldn't be prominently in your field of view. If you are planning on supporting devices such as a cardboard VR device or an Oculus Go where you don't have a positionally tracked controller, you'll want to do the same. But in our game, we have tracked controllers, and we can do something no traditional FPS game can offer. We can rely on hand-eye coordination, and it is this where VR games have a serious edge on traditional games. We are thus going to child our raycast to our gun. We then move it right in front of our muzzle. I'm putting it just outside of our gun's collision shape just in case. Our raycast points down by default, so we need to adjust its settings so it is cast into the right direction. Also by default, our raycast is disabled. If we want it to work, we need to enable it. We also want to set our collision mask to our environment and objects layer. Our pistol doesn't have a laser scope, but I'm going to claim some artistic license here for the purpose of demonstrating how our raycast system works. I'm adding a mesh instance as a child to our raycast and set its shape to a small sphere. We'll add a material to our mesh instance. This should be a transparent material with our albedo color set to red. It will also be unshaded as it's just a laser light and not affected by any lights in our scene. To implement shooting, we need to enhance the logic in the script for our gun. However, we don't want to implement this on our pickable object code as this is specific to this gun. We thus create a new script that we create in our gun subfolder. Instead of the script being extended from Node, we want to extend it from our pickable object script. We can quickly do this by finding our script in our file browser and then just dragging our script into our code. Godot will nicely fill in the path for us. Let's get rid of our default code. Before we write any code, it does make sense to give our laser pointer and our raycast a proper name. Now we can assign our script as the script for our gun. We're adding our logic into our process function. We simply check if our raycast is colliding. If it is, we assign the global position of our laser pointer to the location of our collision. In order to assign the global position, we modify the origin vector of our global transform. Finally, we want to make sure we can see our laser pointer. If our raycast is not colliding, we hide our laser pointer. Once we pick up our gun, we can point it around and we'll see our laser dot where we're aiming at. Note that it will hit any collision shape we've got, but not interact with surfaces for which we haven't created collision shapes. Now that we know what we would hit when we pull the trigger, we need to make something happen. There are two sides to this, firing the gun and doing something when we hit the target. In this video, we're only going to react to the player pulling the trigger. We'll look into adding fancy animations in our next video. We are also going to show bullet holes where we hit the target, and that will be the main focus of the remainder of this video. The solution I'm about to show is just one of many. It works well when we have a defined target, but it's pretty limited otherwise. We have to start somewhere, and I do plan to look into other techniques as we progress in this series. We'll be using a 2D viewport so we can render our bullet holes into our texture. Let's create that viewport and set it up. We change the size of our viewport to match the size of the texture we are using. We change our usage to 2D, and just to be safe, we disable 3D. We also change our update mode to once. In order to render our target texture, we need to add a texture rect to our viewport. We assign our target texture to this texture rect. Note that because this is not our main viewport, we don't see what we're adding in our preview window. Let's also quickly rename our node to background. Now we add a second rect for our bullet graphic. And we assign our bullet texture to this texture rect. Our texture is too big, so I'm going to scale it down to half its size. And we rename it to bullet hole. One thing I forgot is that we also need to change the clear mode of the viewport to never, as we'll be drawing over our previous results. Let's add a script to our root node so we can add some logic. I'm going to start by creating a new material for this instance. While we have only one target at the moment, once we instance our scene, each target will need its own material. The only property we set on our new material is our albedo texture, and we set this to the output texture of our viewport. To round this off, we assign our new material to the material override of the mesh instance. Doing a quick preview, we can just about see that our bullet hole is shown in the left bottom corner of our target. We also see that our target texture is upside down. That our texture is upside down is pretty easy to fix. We just select our viewport node and select our V flip option. We also hide our bullet texture because we only want our bullet hole to be drawn when we actually shoot. I'm going to add two methods to our target code. The first we won't actually use in this video, but I just want to show the principle here. This method will reset our target texture by making our background texture visible and our bullet hole invisible and issuing a single update of the viewport. The second method is the method we call when we actually hit our target, and it gets the global location in 3D space where it was hit as an input. We need to convert this hit point to a location in our 2D viewport. For this, we first get the global transform for our target, and we apply the inverse of this transform to our hit point. This gets our coordinate in the target's local space. We can now ignore our depth and simply scale our two remaining axes. We divide by the size of our quad and then multiply by the size of our viewport. Note that I did forget about the rotate, as we'll see in a minute. Now we position our bullet hole texture at these coordinates. And we perform the same trick as our clear, but now we make the background invisible and our bullet hole visible. Then we trigger an update of our viewport. As our viewport isn't getting cleared, our bullet hole texture is rendered on top of our previous result. This next bit is the only part that I may decide to change, but we now need to react to the user pulling the trigger. Seeing it is our pickup function script that knows what object we have in our hands, and thus what object should react, it makes sense to have this logic here. We'll add an export variable that we can set to the button ID of our trigger button. Then, in our button pressed function, we check if that button was pressed. If so, we check if we are indeed holding an object, and if that object has an action method. Note, I am making a typo here. The method call is hasMethod, not has. We'll fix that in a minute. If we have an action method, we call it. We implement this action method on our gun script. Remember, this is the script that extends our pickable object script. We check if our raycast is colliding with an object. If so, we get that object and check if that object has a method called hit. Note, I'm making the same typo here. If we have that method, we call it and pass it our collision point. By calling a method on the object we hit with our weapon, we can leave it up to the object to react. Our target is drawing a bullet hole, but if we hit a shield, we may trigger a shield effect, or if it's an enemy, we may record damage on it. So testing this, I found my typos. Note the quick fix in these two places. We can see that things nearly work. We get our bullet holes, but we're only positioning it on the vertical axis and upside down. As I rotate at my target by 90 degrees, we need to use the Z axis for our horizontal coordinate. We also need to subtract our coordinates to get things the right way around. Finally, we're going to center our bullet hole texture on our coordinates. As I scaled this texture, it is 64 by 64 pixels. We thus need to subtract 32 from each axis. And there we have it. We can shoot at our target and bullet holes magically appear. Now they only appear on the target. We can shoot the walls all we want. And this technique is definitely not suitable for the walls. In the next video, we're going to start dressing this up. Add some effects, and add some gunshots. If you enjoyed this video, I would appreciate a like. Please consider subscribing. I use Twitter to announce what I'm working on and show off in between things, so you can follow me there if you're interested. Thanks for watching, and until next time.